Well, good afternoon. Why don't we get started? Thank you for joining us this afternoon to hear from our distinguished guests, who earlier today were presented with the 2019 Albany Medical Center Prize in Medicine and Biomedical Research. We're delighted that they were both able to take time to share their research and their insights with us this afternoon. I know I, for one, am looking forward to their presentations and to our follow-up discussions. Let me begin by introducing our guests. To my immediate right, Dr. Bert Vogelstein is the Clayton Professor of Oncology and Pathology, co-director of the Ludwig Center at the Kimmel Cancer Center, and director of the Lustgarten Laboratory for Pancreatic Cancer Research, all at Johns Hopkins University. Dr. Vogelstein attended the University of Pennsylvania, where he graduated summa cum laude with distinction in mathematics. He received his medical degree from Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine and pursued his internship and residency training in pediatrics at the Johns Hopkins Hospital. Following his residency, Dr. Vogelstein completed a postdoctoral fellowship at the National Cancer Institute, focusing on new techniques in molecular biology, before then returning back to Johns Hopkins. Dr. Vogelstein is well published and known worldwide for his insights into cancer genomics, and he is a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the National Academy of Sciences, and the American Philosophical Society, and is a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Dr. Vogelstein has won numerous prestigious awards for his pioneering studies on the pathogenesis of human cancer, including today, the Albany Med Prize. To our far right is Dr. Irving Weissman. He is the director of the Stanford Institute for Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine and the director of the Stanford Ludwig Cancer Center and Center for Stem Cell Research and Medicine. He is also the Virginia and D.K. Ludwig Professor for Clinical Investigation and Cancer Research at Stanford. Dr. Weissman was born and raised in Montana. He received his Bachelor of Science degree from Montana State University, graduated from Stanford Medical School in 1965, and has been at Stanford ever since. A world-renowned scientist, widely respected for his innovation and leadership, he has published more than 900 papers, received multiple patents, and co-founded a number of biotechnology companies to develop new therapies based on scientific discoveries from his lab. Dr. Weissman is a member of the National Academy of Sciences, the Institute of Medicine at the National Academy, and the American Association of Arts and Sciences. He, too, is a recipient of numerous awards, including today, the Albany Med Prize. Drs. Vogelstein and Weissman received the Albany Prize in recognition of their respective immense bodies of research that have altered the modern understanding of cancer biology and cancer genetics, changing the paradigm for cancer research. Their creative, insightful discoveries that have yielded new and emerging therapies for cancer and other degenerative disease embody the vision of the Albany Prize. In a nutshell, their major contributions to our understanding of what causes a tumor to grow and how it becomes malignant have contributed to the development of new ways to detect and treat cancer, leading to novel approaches capable of prolonging the lives of those who at one time would have been considered incurable. Please join me in welcoming a round of applause for the recipients of the 2019 Albany Medical Center Prize. Joe? So as has been our history, the format of today's grand rounds will be as follows. Each of our distinguished guests will discuss their work, and following their presentations, we'll have an opportunity for you to ask questions that they've agreed to be responsive to. In the past, these have always led to very insightful discussions, and so let's not any further ado. Can we start with you, Dr. Vogelstein, for your presentation?
First, thank you for the very kind introduction. I assume my microphone is on. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. And it is, of course, an honor and a privilege to receive this prestigious award and to speak to you today. And I should start by acknowledging the people in my laboratory, as well as the laboratories with which we collaborate, both inside Hopkins and outside, who have performed the work that this award honors. This is a picture taken a few years ago, which includes our lab and laboratories adjacent to ours, with whom we collaborate. And I'd especially like to point out Ken Kinsler, who's in the front, who's my research partner, and who has been responsible for many of the most important discoveries our laboratory has made over the years. I will talk today about three related issues. The first is the quantification of cancer genes, what they are and how many there are. The second is how we exploit this knowledge about cancer genes to develop novel therapeutics. And the third is how we exploit them for diagnostics. And I'll start with quantification because there have been so many studies on cancer genes since the advent of next generation sequencing in the last 10 years that this field seems very complex, particularly to those not in the field, but I have to say even to those of us in the field, it seems immensely complicated. And what I will try to do in the next few slides is cut through to the essence of what has been discovered. And let me illustrate that with this slide, which illustrates the genetic alterations in genes that change one amino acid to another, that is non-synonymous mutations encoding genes, in a typical pancreatic cancer, PA34. Each of those little black rings represents a mutation, and they're overlaid on petals representing the chromosomes, pianos like piano petals or piano keys. And you can see there are about 50 of them, and this looks pretty complex, 50 mutations in a single cancer. But if you wipe away all of the irrelevant genes and just focus on the driver genes, you see that there are only three or perhaps four in each individual cancer. In this particular cancer, there were four. And the genes are familiar to all of you. One is KRAS, one is TP53, certainly widespread in their mutations within different cancers. The third is SMAD4, also commonly mutated. It's a member of the TGF-beta pathway, a signaling network. And the fourth is a gene, SMARCA4, which controls epigenetic changes. And this is all it takes, about three. The remaining genes are passengers. They've just come along for the ride. Now, why are they there? They're there because all cancers are derived from stem cells. And this is something that relates the work of our lab to Irv's lab, as you'll hear next. And because they're stem cells, they all have mutations, even normal stem cells. If you were to look at a stem cell in your own body, anyone, pick one from the pancreas, pick one from the colon, from the blood, it doesn't matter. You would see that that single cell has about 50 mutations. It depends on the tissue type and the number of replications, but every time a stem cell divides, every time any cell divides, about five new mutations appear. And if by chance one of those new mutations is in an oncogene or tumor suppressor gene, it can initiate the process of neoplasia. Now, how many such driver genes are there? Not many. Again, this is something that seems very complicated in the literature. If you look through the literature, you'll see thousands of genes which have been proposed to be cancer driver genes. I think the best list, the most recent list, was published just last week in Nucleic Acids Research. And this list agrees with some algorithms that we've used. There are only about 120 in all cancers combined. 74 of them, roughly, are tumor suppressors. 47 are oncogenes. That's less than 1% of the total coding genes in the human genome. And they are responsible in aggregate for the vast majority of cancers that occur in the world today. Now, this is really good news, because 50 years ago, when Irv and I were starting our prospective lines of research, we had no idea of what causes cancer. And there, you could not have predicted that the same genes that cause pancreatic cancer are those that cause colon cancer, that they overlap so much. But the truth is, they do overlap quite a bit. There are only 121 genes or so. And in fact, it's even a little bit simpler than that. All these genes work within a defined set of about a dozen pathways at most, which gives enormous hope for the future. Because once you understand a disease, once you understand these pathways better, now that we know these genes, that means we'll eventually be able to come up with better therapies as well as better preventive measures. Now, these three mutations that are responsible for solid tumors, it takes fewer mutations to get to a liquid tumor or a pediatric tumor, but a common solid tumor in adults, it takes about three. The first one is the initiating mutation. This is the one that occurs in the normal stem cell and starts the process. It leads to a benign overgrowth, not many cells, microscopic often, and it stays that way until there's a second mutation, which results in the expansion of that neoplastic cell clone to something that may no longer be microscopic, but is importantly benign. It's only with the advent of the third mutation that the tumor becomes invasive. We're talking here about solid tumors, can invade through the basement membrane and thus distinguishes the benign state from the malignant state. And this process is not instantaneous. Mutations do not occur very commonly in stem cells nor in cancer cells. The mutation rate in most cancer cells is no higher than in normal stem cells. The process takes somewhere between 20 to 30 years. And that's also good news, because it means there's a long time for intervention in the process. And that time frame will figure prominently in the last part of my talk. Now, how do we exploit them therapeutically? Obviously, you're all aware of targeted therapies. I will tell you one story that developed in our lab, which is perhaps emblematic. And this story started with someone who wasn't in our lab, an adjacent lab, Suzanne Topalian, who published this landmark paper in the New England Journal showing that immune checkpoint therapies, in particular anti-PD-1, were very effective in patients with melanomas and lung cancers, but not in patients with other tumors, such as colon cancers, breast cancers, pancreatic cancers, and most other solid tumors. Now, why not? She couldn't answer that question. She worked closely with Drew Pardoll, who's an immunologist. I think it's fair to say they worked intimately together. They're married. And Drew was my first graduate student, actually, in the 80s. And Drew and Suzanne came to visit us and said, can you provide any explanation for why these two tumors in particular respond so well, but not the others? And the explanation became clear to us pretty soon after that discussion began. This is a graph depicting on the y-axis the number of non-synonymous, that is protein-changing, amino acid-changing amino acids in the genome. And on the x-axis is a bunch of different cancers. Now, most cancers, as you see here, esophageal, colon, head and neck, etc., have roughly about 50 mutations per genome. It varies, of course, depending on the type and the individual cancer, from 25 to 100, but on average or median, it's about 50. Now, there are three exceptions. Lung cancers, either small cell or non-small cell, and melanomas. which have hundreds of mutations, not dozens of mutations. Now, why is that? It's, of course, because these patients' cancers are caused by, if I use that word a little bit loosely, sunlight, and cigarette smoke, which induce many more mutations, and including driver gene mutations. So these tumors have lots of mutations. Most of them are passengers, but they're still mutations. And because there's so many mutations, each one of those mutations can form a neoantigen that the individual has never been exposed to when it changes an amino acid, setting the stage for productive immunotherapy with an immune checkpoint inhibitor. So we thought that would be the explanation for why these two tumor types responded, lung and melanoma, and the other ones didn't. But we also noticed another type of cancer, mismatch repair deficient cancers, which from genetic analyses had been shown to have 1,000 or more protein coding alterations per genome. And we postulated that these tumors, mismatch repair deficient cancers, would be incredibly susceptible to immune checkpoint inhibitors. Now, that seems obvious now, but it wasn't then. We submitted this idea for publication, and the rejections were speedy and unambiguous. No chance for resubmission. And the reason was because genetics had not then been connected with immunology. But we thought this idea was pretty compelling, and so compelling, in fact, that we started a clinical trial which we at Hopkins had to pay for. The idea wasn't popular, but we thought if we paid for it, maybe we could do it. And we did, and we convinced Merck, who generously was able to provide the drug, but the trial was carried out at Johns Hopkins and paid for by Johns Hopkins. And I'm sure all of you are aware of the result. They were very positive. Here is a waterfall plot showing how many mismatch repair deficient cancers responded to immune checkpoint inhibitor, now called Keytruda. It's the great majority of them, some of them with durable responses. It worked no matter what tumor type, as long as the tumor was mismatch repair deficient. And this, a couple of years later, stimulated the FDA to approve it. And according to them, that approval marked the first time a tissue agnostic cancer therapy was ever approved. It didn't depend on the tissue type. It's simply dependent on the nature of the genetic alterations within that tumor. It's a kind of realization of precision medicine. It's not the tumor, but the real understanding of the tumor, the genetic alterations that have led to that tumor that are important and can be used therapeutically. The second example of exploitation of this knowledge that I'll discuss is diagnostics. Now, there has always been this kind of antagonism between prevention versus cure. What's the best way to do this for any disease, including cancer? In my view, maybe because I started out in pediatrics, it's unequivocally prevention if you can do it. The old adage, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, is certainly true for cancer when you can do it. So once these genetic alterations became in focus, we started to devote a lot of our lab's efforts to new ways of prevention, in particular secondary prevention, which means early detection and intervention. And our first publication on this topic was actually close to, I guess, 27 years ago in Science, when we showed that you could detect RAS gene mutations in the stool of patients with colorectal cancers. Now, it took quite a long time to get to the technology where this could actually be applied, but now it is. There's a test sold by Exact Sciences called Cologuard, and that represented the first FDA-approved test for invasive cancers based on somatic genetic alterations that was accomplished. And this test is now being widely applied and hopefully will prevent many deaths as well as morbidity from the disease in the future. More recently, we focused on blood tests. Blood tests have the advantage that one could, at least in theory, look for mutations in, again, this set of 121 genes, actually a selected subset of them, and detect evidence of cancers in the blood of patients with many different types of tumors. And in this study, published last year in Science, we showed that such a test could be developed, at least in principle. And the test looked for genetic alterations in a limited subset of genes or elevated protein levels, which was useful to increase sensitivity. In developing this test, we knew that it would have to be relatively inexpensive to actually be used, like any other screening test. So that's one of the reasons we chose relatively few genes and proteins to look at. And let me just give you an update on that study as of a couple of weeks ago. We've looked at 812 healthy controls and 883 cancers from seven different types, which together account for certainly more than half of cancer deaths in the United States. All of these cancers were not advanced. None of them contained distant metastases. And the results are shown here. In the normal population, there was 99.5% specificity, which means there were only four false positives out of the 812 healthy controls. And these are the seven types. Common types: ovary, liver, pancreas, esophagus, etc. The median sensitivity is over 80%, and most of the sensitivities are close to 75% or higher. So this is getting there to where a test might be conceivable. Now, I point out that this is a retrospective study. We're looking at patients who already had cancers. Not advanced, but still they had cancer. Many of them had already had symptoms. What we will need to do if we ever want to establish rigorous evidence that this test is useful is to be studied a prospective study in otherwise healthy individuals. And we've started that. We haven't finished it. But the study will involve 10,000 healthy individuals between age 65 and 75. We've already recruited those individuals. We've tested all those individuals, but we haven't completed the analysis or follow-up. But hopefully the study will be completed in the next 6 months and will reveal what the actual sensitivity and specificity is in a target population. I want to leave you with one final thought, my view for exploiting this genetic information in the future. And here I'll bring together therapeutics and diagnostics. My hope for the future is based on the next three slides. This slide represents patients treated with conventional chemotherapy who had colorectal cancer, who were less than stage four. That is, no evident metastases on imaging. If you treat those patients in an adjuvant setting, what you're really doing is treating micrometastases, metastases smaller than you can see on a CT scan. And when you do that, you find you can cure, not just put into remission, close to 50%. 47% is the actual number of patients. If you wait till those patients develop disease that's large enough to see in a CT scan, that is, they have visible metastases, you cure zero. So these are patients with metastases that can be cured. And it doesn't just apply to conventional chemotherapy. Look at immunotherapy, the most promising therapies on the horizon. This is with immune checkpoint inhibitors. It's a paper from Nature. Patients with low tumor burden are very often driven into long-term remissions with these agents, whereas with a high tumor burden, it's much less common. The same is even true with T cells, with CAR T cells. It works better when there's low disease burden than with high, and it doesn't take sophisticated mathematics to understand why. The likelihood of recurrence is directly related to the number of cells, because the number of cells is directly related to the probability that a mutation will occur in at least one of those cells, those cancer stem cells, making it resistant to therapy. The smaller burden of tumor, the more likely such a cell does not exist and the patient will be cured. So my hope for the future is outlined on this slide. That earlier detection, it doesn't just have to be at stage one, but just earlier than when patients have already clinically evident, radiologically visible metastases, combined with new therapies, of which you'll hear some about in a few minutes, will together reduce cancer deaths. And if I am to get up on my soapbox for just a minute, I'll say the amount of research that's devoted to prevention, either primary or secondary, is much less than the amount devoted to therapies of advanced cancers by pharmaceutical companies as well as by philanthropic and government agencies, and I'd like to see that balance more in line with the importance of each approach. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Vogelstein. Dr. Weissman, would you like to have a shot at it?
Why not?
All right.
So if somebody would switch or go forward. Here we go. So I'm a stem cell biologist. Actually, before that, I was an immunologist. Before that, like Dr. Vogelstein, I'm an MD. The field that I guess you would say opened is finding and purifying and testing the function of stem cells. The very first stem cell that we searched for and found was the blood-forming stem cell. There. You'll see a monotonous picture of that. It's the same cell. I'm not saying that I had looked at two. What's the property of a stem cell that makes it unique and important to study? It's easy. When it divides, on average, one of the two daughter cells is still a stem cell. Expresses the same genes as the cell it came from. The other one, on average, has changed the set of genes. And in the blood-forming system, the other one would be what we call a short-term stem cell or a multipotent stem cell. And that cell, at the single-cell level, like the stem cell, can make all blood cells, but it can't self-renew. So self-renewal is the critical property to understand what a stem cell is. When we isolated the blood-forming stem cell and transplanted it, first in mice, we found it made blood and only blood. And I'll just say, for that one statement in our paper, there were probably 50 that said, no, we're going to take fat, or we're going to take your bone, and we're going to put it in, and it'll fix heart lesions in the brain, and so on. No science. So we had to understand what it was, not only to develop therapies, but sadly in this world, expose the frauds who are making claims that had no science behind it. Now, because this is a self-renewing cell, it looks like it's only made once. As the embryo switches to what's called the fetus, as something that doesn't look like anything you know, to something that starts making each of the organs. Stem cells first come up when you make organs. Bone marrow for the blood, lung for the lung, brain for the brain, and so on. And we and a few others have isolated many of them in mice and some in humans. Because they're only made once, they are responsible for maintaining this system throughout life. For me, I'm going to be 80 next month. That's 80 plus whatever it is, 6 months. Still going strong. And, following up on the lead that Bert made, when something goes wrong and you get a leukemia, we know that it starts the process in stem cells. Now, a lot of blood diseases, myelodysplastic syndrome, adult onset anemias, and so on, occur late in life. You've had tons of stem cells around. And you would wonder how you could have a disease that starts late in life, start with maybe a mutation in a single stem cell. I hope I'm going to reveal that to you, but I want you to say thanks, because nobody believed this until we actually tested it. All right. Now, once we isolated the mouse blood-forming stem cell, we wanted to and isolated the human blood-forming stem cell. The real test of a stem cell is, will it save a lethally irradiated animal by making blood cells for life and self-renewing? Now, we could do that with mice. The question was, how would we do that with humans? And I'll just say, in passing, that we used a mouse we called the severe combined immune deficient humanized mouse. A mouse that didn't have immune cells to reject human tissues, and into which we put human fetal bone for bone marrow, liver for late stage blood formation, thymus to make new T cells, spleen and lymph node to see if you can make an immune response. Then when we did it, 1988 to 1992, now that's the only way we've been able to isolate a tissue stem cell. I'm not going to go into all of the, until the discussion of the ethical and medical ethical issues we went into, but I'll just say in passing that Joe Grogan, Mick Mulvaney, and Mike Pence, and Donald Trump have banned the use of human fetal tissues in medical research funded by the NIH, and that includes all students, postdocs, and labs. So today, if we were starting, we could not isolate stem cells, and the therapeutics I'm about to show you could not have happened, certainly for the people who had a narrow window of time in which it had to happen or they were dead. I'm not a politician, I'm just telling you the facts. All right, so now, we developed a method to find the 1 in 100,000 to 1 in 200,000 blood-forming stem cells in the bone marrow. And when we looked at the bone marrow, say, of women with metastatic breast cancer, the breast cancer, more often than not, was in the bone marrow. And the treatment in the 1990s that involved bone marrow or mobilized blood transplant was to take out some of the mobilized blood, freeze it down as living cells. then give them a supra-lethal dose of combination chemotherapy beyond what they could stand on their own, with the hope, as Bert said, it's all numbers, that you're decreasing more and more the cells as you give higher and higher combination chemotherapy doses. And then thaw the cells and inject them back in. But what they were injecting back in, more often than not, were cancer cells. And that was my first real surprise about medical education. Almost none of the breast cancer doctors or the bone marrow transplanters I talked to said, why would you want to get rid of the cancer cells? And I said, because a century of cancer biology tells us if you inject them into an immune deficient or depleted host, they will grow. And they hadn't heard of the idea. Because they are empiricists, and being good doctors, they memorize the best of the textbooks, the best conclusions, and the pearls of wisdom from their senior doctors. It was an apprenticeship, not a graduate study of medicine. This, over and over and over again, has proved to be the single largest barrier that we've seen in doing this. But we wanted to be able to get rid of cancers by sorting positively for stem cells. And if we were going to do a donor-to-host transplant, we also needed to get rid of T cells. And we found with this method, in general, at a company I co-founded, Systemics, that we could get rid of cancers and T cells. So now I'm going to show you the long-term results of a clinical trial that we did at Stanford University from 1996 to 1998. These were women, all of whom had widely metastatic breast cancer, mostly with bony lesions wherever the bones were. So no local therapy could be curative. So we took the high-dose chemotherapy of the combination, it doesn't matter what the names are, three different drugs that kill, dividing cells and cancer cells. We gave them a lethal dose. And we rescued them with our purified cancer-free stem cells. And in concert at the same time at Stanford, there were lots of patients, same group, same doc, same drugs, not prospectively randomized, were given back the mobilized blood that we knew at least 60% of the samples had cancer cells in them. And we're looking at the overall survival in this experiment, which we published in 12. I think. The women who got mobilized blood had a median survival of about 26 months. It was in the 90s. It's the same today. You have metastatic breast cancer, your median survival is going to be about 25, 26 months. And every time new drugs come up, the breast cancer doctors say, we won't need to do yours because the new drugs are going to work. Okay? I've checked with it. All of the patients are dead now. Of their disease or something else. But the women who got cancer-free stem cells, the median survival was 10 years. They didn't see a doctor for their breast cancer during all that time. They raised their kids. They made money. They did whatever it was their life was allowing them to do. Today, because I checked recently, one-third of the women are alive without disease. This is a no-brainer. It should be a therapy, right? All of us should have that opportunity for our families. But it isn't. A very large corporation bought the company that was, I found it was doing it, promising us they would do everything that I'm going to say in this talk to take stem cells forward. But they closed it down when they got a drug. It's in concert with their getting a drug. I want to say it's because they got a drug. but it was highly profitable. So, lesson number two. The bigger barrier is the education in our medical people. A second one is we don't understand clinical translation. We believe we make a discovery, we hand it over to biotech, pharma, and they will think how to make it go forward. They'll tell us that. And I've started many companies, and I've consulted for companies. But the function of a company is to make a profit. And that's correct. If you had any other reason that the company existed, the company would go out of existence, at least in any place that's regulated appropriately. So the mistake is thinking that we should hand over our discoveries at an early time point and hope they keep it going with the same drive, intelligence, and of course, desire to advance medicine for people. So that'll open up some discussion. But I want you to understand, that's one of the differences. Now, Bert didn't say it exactly, but Bert showed early on in colorectal cancer that there appears to be an order of mutations that occur that lead to the colorectal cancer. And some would be early, APC, and some would be late. We had stem cells. We had isolated stem cells from patients with a variety of leukemias. After Hiroshima bomb, we isolated stem cells. Chronic myelogenous leukemia, we isolated stem cells. All different kinds of acute myelogenous leukemia and other diseases related to leukemia as pre-leukemic diseases. And the question we asked, read that down, homage to Bert Vogelstein, was, do these changes occur in the blood-forming system in any cell that makes blood? And of course, mutations are random. So it's happening probably with roughly equal frequency in any cell. But what we had shown is every cell downstream of the stem cell that's going toward blood has a finite lifespan. And none of the mutations that we are examining could convert the lifespan of that cell or turn it into a self-renewing, blood-forming stem cell. So we changed our minds about the hypothesis. Obviously, I could tell from what Bert was saying, he was thinking about it also, that these mutations are hitchhiking in a clone of blood-forming stem cells. So that when you finally get the leukemia stem cell, which we isolated in all the cases I told you, and did a DNA sequence of them. We didn't do a full DNA sequence. We did the express gene sequence. We would get mutations. And we knew by the names of the mutations that each was rare and independent of the other. So let's say there were seven mutations that led to an acute myelogenous leukemia. We proposed there'd be a cell with six, a cell with five, four, three, two, one. And then we could find it. So we sequenced 21 straight acute myelogenous leukemias. We got out the mutations. We made DNA probes specific for each one. The vast majority, as Bert said, turned out to be non-recurring passengers. But there were recurring mutations. The names for those who want to know, TET2, IDH1, IDH2, DNMT3A, CTCF, beta-catenin activation. And all of those we were interested in. But I'm just going to say that as a result of this, we found in all 21 that we could get the full list of mutations. And only the last mutation was in the leukemia stem cell, but not apparently in the precursor to the leukemia stem cell of the self-renewing property. Now, you might think that's innocent, but I just wanted to say the last one. And FLT3 and turtle tendon repeat for the physicians in the audience was always last in a leukemia with that. Same with NRAS, same with KRAS, same with beta-catenin. There's probably another one I haven't remembered. But it says there's an order. What about the first mutations? The first mutations altered, which genes would be opened up to differentiate from a stem cell to the next cell, or which genes would be shut off as you go. And as you know, those are suites of genes that do it. And to have open or closed chromatin for transcription of RNA so the proteins could be made is pretty complicated. The genes that were mutated lost the ability to open up closed DNA, TET2, IDH1, IDH2, or lost the ability to take open chromatin that's being expressed and shut it down, DNMT3A. Now, there'll be more like that, but if you just think about it, now you have a population of stem cells that live in homes for stem cells. I didn't tell you that. And they're proliferating, but sometimes now they fail to differentiate. So we want to follow that hypothesis to say, why is that early? Does it have something to do with the competition between blood-forming stem cells that are getting diseased or not? The next point, we're still okay, is that a single mutation can lead to a clone of stem cells that expands dramatically. My student, after he left my lab, unfortunately, but still, Sid Jaiswal with Ben Ebert showed, the older you get, the more likely you are to have one of these blood-forming stem cell clones. And obviously, if you have to go to 7 to make a leukemia, if you only have one, there's many more people with one than 7. Hundreds or thousands fold more. So that clonal hematopoiesis, he's already shown, just with a couple quick assays, are much more likely to get a blood disease or leukemia than those that don't have it. The second, which is totally unexpected, is other than smoking, it's the highest risk factor for getting atherosclerotic disease that causes heart attacks, strokes, and aneurysms. And we've helped work that out with Nick Lieber, but I just wanted you to know that. Wendy Pang, brilliant student in my lab, showed in a disease mainly of people my age, where you walk into the doc, you get a blood test, not enough red cells or not enough platelets or not enough neutrophils, that this myelodysplastic syndrome comes from a single stem cell with a chromosomal anomaly that takes over all of the homes for stem cells. So it is the most competitive stem cell around. But it can't make blood because it puts on an eat me signal that the cells that like to eat dangerous cells clears it out. It's probably the mechanism of the disease. So it's a stem cell disease. You don't get it till you're about my age. So it's certainly adult onset. I'm going to go back just for one more thing. As Bert said, we get cancers in tissues that have stem cells. If this is true, this mutational succession that Bert started, we can expect the same to happen in colorectal cancer stem cells, the intestinal stem cells, the brain stem cells that Ann and I isolated, in glioblastoma, medulloblastoma, pontine glioma. So we're testing each of these to see if the hypothesis is correct. And because a single mutation or chromosomal anomaly, there we go, it's almost dead, can dominate the field that those stem cells are in and cause a disease, this is an opening to look for new diseases by clonal expansion of brain stem cells or intestinal stem cells or lung stem cells. Just so you got it. Okay, quickly. When we compared, we beating Ravi Majeti, Dave Traver and I, and Sid Jaiswal, when we compared the genes that were expressed in highly purified leukemia stem cells, that's blue, and normal blood-forming stem cells, we found at least one gene was overexpressed, which is a don't-eat-me signal. It's called CD47. It's not my fault that's the name. It's just the name. And it is a don't eat me signal for the scavenger macrophages in the body that are looking around and finding cells that have an eat me signal and attempt to eat them and kill them and then use their contents. We found CD47 was the top ranked upregulated in leukemias. And then we found that every mouse and every human leukemia had upregulated CD47. And we found every cancer we tested. When we tested human acute myelogenous leukemia stem cells painted green, mixed it together with human macrophages, so this is all from humans, and we made an antibody that blocked the interaction between the don't eat me signal on the tumor cell and its receptor on a macrophage, they got eaten. And this is just to say, every Stanford University leukemia we looked at got eaten with this blocking antibody and this one, but luckily not normal bone marrow cells or normal blood-forming stem cells. So that's our margin, our therapeutic margin. So we wanted to see, is this really, in this kind of leukemia, a therapeutic? So this was just reported a couple months ago at the ASCO meeting, a company I co-founded, have stock in, therefore might be biased, called 47 Inc., odd name for a company. We treated patients with acute myelogenous leukemia, either elderly ones or ones that had failed other therapy. And if we give anti-CD47 along with a drug that's easily tolerated, which can help a lot of leukemia patients, so far, all of the patients with either that myelodysplastic syndrome or acute myelogenous leukemia have gone into a remission. We don't know how long because we just reported the beginning of it. We don't know if it's going to be a cure or just yet another drug in the repertoire. When we looked at every one of these other cancers, which we insisted we get the primary cancer from the patient, we make a cell suspension and we put it into the same organ of an immune deficient mouse. So brain to brain, as in this glioblastoma, breast to breast, bladder to bladder, so on. All of them grew, and all of them were susceptible to anti-CD47. I didn't know Bert was going to say a small tumor thing, but here you go. We cured small tumors. We cured the small metastases from the tumor, but a large tumor we couldn't catch up with. And it's for the same reason. This is an immune therapy. Our immune cell happens to be a scavenger macrophage. It's hard to keep up with it. So in order to try to improve our method of treating tumors, we tested known antibodies that are therapeutics in humans. This one's called rituximab. Rituximab sees the molecule CD20 that's on normal B cells and so far almost all malignant non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. And so we said if we could put an antibody that saw CD20 that connected with a big eating molecule called the Fc receptor on macrophages, it should synergize with blocking the don't eat me signal and adding a huge eat me signal. This was our test in the laboratory, growth of a primary large cell lymphoma, stasis with our antibody, stasis with the rituximab treatment. This is the first or second patient with lymphoma that we treated with that combination. Massive tumor sites going away are gone. That's the imaging in the bladder and the heart. And this is the kind of plot that we saw before. Remission, progression with that combination. But these patients had failed all other therapies. Rituximab, rituximab plus CHOP, two had CAR T-cell therapies, and now we got about half of them with long remissions so far. So I think we have proof of principle. But we didn't cure all of them. We didn't even see an effect on these patients. So just to be a little more complete, Roy Moat, Amira Barkal, Sydney Gordon, and I developed a way of looking for other don't-eat-me signals and their receptors in the eating cells, macrophages. And we've published PD-1 and PD-L1, which the big success for T-cell therapies, the macrophages in the tumors have PD-1. It delivers the same negative signal as the CD47 receptor did on macrophages. MHC class 1 beta 2 microglobulin and LILRB1, and as we published last week, CD24 and Siglec-10. 24 and Siglec-10 are really interesting because they're on triple negative breast cancer and ovarian cancers, which have resisted our single antibody therapy so far. So, like Bert said, if we have as our goal not just making money, but trying to devise a code of what you would treat a patient with a particular cancer, we'd do this. Now, you saw that long period of the experiment we did in 96 to 98. We give high-dose chemotherapy, and their tumor didn't come back until 10 years. Well, roughly knowing the dividing time of those breast cancer cells, we were probably much less than a million and probably close to 10,000 or 1,000 cancer cells less somewhere in the body. So we believe, and if we are lucky, we can convince some group to fund a clinical trial that we do that high-dose chemotherapy, rescue them with massive numbers of their own cancer-free stem cells, and when they make the eating cells, hit them with these immunotherapies. We want to turn metastatic breast cancer into a highly curable disease. And as I said, we're going up against upstream, very heavy upstream of medical education and commercial interests. Now, as a quick aside, I'll just say the same system, Nick Leeper and I have shown, are working on the blood vessel cells that cause atherosclerosis. So in atherosclerosis, you have a blood vessel, and somewhere in it, focally, there's a bump inside the blood vessel. Not all of it. So if my high-fat diet and lack of exercise and other stuff were generally working, it should be closing the whole vessel, but it doesn't. And Nick Leeper and Yoko Kojima and I have found it's a clone of smooth muscle cells that are damaged, that are growing. They'll never make a cancer because they'll kill you before they ever became a cancer. And they express the don't eat me and the eat me signal. And in a mouse model, we can prevent the development of atherosclerosis in an ApoE knockout mouse on a high-fat diet simply with infusion of the antibody. We don't want to do it as a preventative for this one. We want to just understand and see what's the best way to go. Same with adhesions, fibrotic adhesions, same with pulmonary fibrosis, same with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease that I heard about today. And so in this field, we've realized that the general properties of stem cells and mutations causing clones of stem cells and also altering their behavior can lead to at least experimental models and human examples of those diseases. The last point, and I know it's getting late, but the last point I'll make is when we first purified stem cells back in the 80s, we found that if we transplant those purified stem cells, say from me to Bert, after somebody radiated Bert. And I'm sure there's some ex-labbies who... that those stem cells will make a blood-forming system in Bert that accepts both him and me as the same. When we transplant bone marrow or mobilized blood with the contaminating T cells, they make an immune reaction against the recipient that keeps that recipient in the hospital, kills 10 to 20% of them, and makes bone marrow transplant a last-ditch effort. Okay? So we found with pure stem cells, we get a donor blood-forming system, we get permanent tolerance of organs from the donor, and we reverse autoimmune disease. So we wanted to get rid of radiation chemo so we could treat sickle cell disease and thalassemia and severe combined immune deficiency, type 1 diabetes, lupus, multiple sclerosis, and a whole bunch of other diseases. And we found that if we have an antibody, not against rituximab, but that targets blood-forming stem cells and the anti-CD47, we can get a donor blood-forming system accepted with no radiation, no chemotherapy, and we have co-transplanted insulin-producing islets or skin into them, and they don't ever require immunosuppression. We've done them in situations that exist in families where you'll have somebody who's a match, 25% of the kids, but we also have done it since families are now two kids, there's a 25% chance of a match. You have almost no chance of having a match nowadays. But everybody's got a mother or a father or a sibling or a child where you share one of the two genetic determinants that allows the matching. And Benson George and I just published 2 months ago that we can not only get transplanted stem cells across these barriers, but we put in heart grafts, and the heart graft from the stem cell donor strain is still going a year later, from a third party, was rejected in 13 days. So we see the future of transplantation of hematopoietic cells, hematopoietic stem cells, is get rid of radiation and cytotoxicity unless you're treating cancer. Second, remove the cells you need to remove that radiation did selectively with antibodies. It's outpatient treatment. If we want to get an organ or tissue graft, we co-transplant the two cell types. And of course, that says in the far future, if we ever get to embryonic or iPS cells, making blood-forming stem cells that are engraftable, making liver cells, making brain cells, and so on, that we will have, instead of somebody who had his head crushed or shot as a donor of an organ, we have cell lines available for everybody to do this. So what I've told you is that starting off with just a curiosity-driven search for what might be blood-forming stem cells, like Bert, if you keep your mind open and your eyes open, you think of the clinical translation, this is one of the ways it can go. And this is just blood-forming stem cells. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Dr. Weissman. I'm sure there are not any questions after those two presentations. Yes?
Hi, it was very nice to talk. So, I actually froze my children's umbilical cord, because I heard it has a lot of stem cells. So if you use that stem cell, I believe they don't have they didn't develop when they are born any mutations. Once, when they grew up, there's no sibling available. If they need to get any, the donor, any donor, can you actually apply the stem cell when they're born frozen in the recognition, so it can be utilized to cure their own cancer? Is that possible? Do you know any?
So a lot of people have been induced to spend a lot of money to save cord bloods. Okay? I think that's what you were getting at. So about 8 years ago, 10 years ago, I asked the guy who started the first serious blood bank for cord bloods, a public one, Pablo Rubinstein in New York Blood Center. I said, of the tens or hundreds of thousands of cord bloods you saved, how many were used for the kid later in life? He said one, and it was desperation and didn't work. The cord blood has the same disease as the child. So it might be useful if you could gene modify and fix the genes. But the way it's advertised for private cord blood banks, if I haven't pissed off everybody yet, just get for this one, is as close to a scam as I know. Okay? Yes, we need blood-forming stem cells. Yes, we can isolate them from almost anybody today. We don't have to go back to cord blood.
How about a harder question? Yes, Dr. Desmo?
Thank you for your presentations. So one of the things we teach our students and residents is that if you're obese and have insulin resistant, you are in a pro-inflammatory state. And the pro-inflammatory state leads to more risk for developing malignancies. And my question is, how do you reconcile that with the theory you proposed to us today?
We can both answer. I've got a quick one.
Go ahead.
We just published last year that breast cancers in humans can upregulate CD47. And we looked at the pathway that did it. And to make a long story short, invading T cells mainly that make TNF-alpha bind to the breast cancer TNF-alpha receptor, and if they have NF-kappa-B, the mediator of TNF-alpha receptor, it goes in the nucleus. And 60% of our population have a germline that is heritable enhancer of CD47 expression that has the NF-kappa-B binding site. We proved absolutely that does it. Now we need to go through full genome sequencing, because exome sequencing will work. This is an intron. To say, do the people that have this NF-kappa-B motif in their enhancer, so now it turns into a super enhancer, never shuts off any of the daughter cells, and it allows the immune response, allows the tumor to escape the surrounding macrophages. So you're absolutely right. Inflammation induction does that. And Nick Lieper showed that also for our study of atherosclerotic disease.
Dr. Vogelstein, did you want to comment?
I can look at it from a gene-centric position. Walter Willett and group, his group in conjunction with ours wrote something in Science. It was a policy forum, I think, last year, addressing that very question. How does obesity in particular contribute to cancer? Because today, obesity is the major risk factor for cancer, other than smoking, of course, and lots of cancers. And no one knows. We raised four possible explanations. One is that obesity and fat cells release substances that increase mutation rates or the inflammation itself. There's no better stimulant of cell proliferation than inflammation, right? In a mouse, every agent that you use which causes inflammation will lead to cancer. Even if you put glass in mice skins, at least inflammation, these are observations, are 50, 60 years old. So inflammation induces cancer, and inflammation induces cell proliferation. Now, what is the primary cause of mutations? It's cell division. Every time a cell divides, every time a normal cell, a stem cell, any cell divides, you get five mutations. So inflammation by virtue of stimulating division, can cause mutation. Now, that may not be the answer. It may be mutational, or it could be epigenetic, or it could be what Irv just suggested and have something to do with immunology. But I think this is one of the major questions to answer. How do you connect these epidemiologic observations with the molecular phenotype and pathogenesis of cancer? I don't know the answer. I think it's a great thing to work on.
Another question? Dr. Crosswell?
Given your success with immunotherapy for the high mutation birth cancers, when you think about the perhaps scary thought of inducing mutations and low mutation birth cancers to make them sensitive to immunotherapy?
I'll do my best. Now, what you're suggesting is an interesting idea, and I know I'm going to piss off. It's a company that one of my former students started, which I'm an advisor to. And the idea for that company is exactly what you suggested, is you somehow induce mutations in patients with metastatic disease that then allow you to treat the patient with immune checkpoint inhibitors. Now, the conceptual problem with that is that once you have a patient with metastatic disease, if you induce new antigens, each cancer is going to have a different antigen. And when you say antigens, if you look at this quantitatively, patient with pancreatic cancer, how many functional neoantigens does that tumor have? The answer is zero, which is why pancreatic cancers don't respond to immune checkpoint therapy. In order to it to be functional, it has to have stimulated an immune response, has to react with the patient's own HLA surface molecules, etc. And very few of potential neoantigens actually do that. The reason that it works in mismatch repair deficient cancers or other repair deficient cancers is just because you have thousands. So the probability is you'll have some. So the chances of inducing mutations at a level that are tolerable by the host with some sort of agent other than irradiating. I know Irv wants to irradiate me, but I don't like that idea at all. I think it's slim. I think they have to be there at the incipient primary tumor, and once the horse has left the barn, you know, all these different metastases, that's too late.
Other questions? Someone else? Yes.
What do you see the role for CRISPR systems going forward with either diagnostics or therapeutics?
Okay, so now who am I going to tick off? CRISPR is revolutionary. I mean, we have knocked out genes for years, since 1990, in somatic cells, lots of driver genes that we wanted to look at functions. And it used to take us 2 or 3 years to do it. And now with CRISPR, it takes about a day. I mean, it's just incredible. But the problem for treating cancers with genetic manipulation is not the CRISPR, it's the delivery. No one has been able to deliver large cargoes to cancer cells. And remember, for most diseases that you could, in theory, correct by gene therapy, you don't have to correct all the cells. If you get 50% of a lung back working in order, that person will be fine. But if you leave one cancer cell untouched, one cancer stem cell, the patient is going to relapse. And you can figure out how long it takes, and it's 6 months to a year. And nobody is even close to figuring out how to get any gene therapeutic measure, whether it be CRISPR or all of its progenitors, zinc finger nucleases, etc., into 100% of cancer cells. In fact, when you actually measure what's done even in animal models, the best you can do in an animal model is usually less than 1% of the tumor cells. So the challenge is the delivery. And then if someone figures out how to deliver it, then CRISPR and numerous other agents could prove beneficial. That's one of what I think is the major challenges in cancer research today.
In the non-cancer use of CRISPR, this same efficiency could take a patient with a single gene defect, and many people are doing it, and you fix that gene in their own blood-forming stem cell and put it back. It's still not quite there, but from a few patients, it looks like the hypothesis is correct.
We have time for one more question.
Thank you. It was great, great talk. So if cancers generate mutations and the cancer cells have elevated CD47, and that happens with age, why don't we all prophylactically go on to anti-CD47 therapy when we hit 65? I mean, is there a downside to that?
Almost for sure, but we don't know what it is yet. Right? And you would find out for the first time in a healthy population. Lloyd Old, actually the founder of the Ludwig, was looking at antibody therapies and T-cell therapies in mouse models a long time ago. And the antibody therapy seemed to work beautifully for leukemias, but it enhanced the growth of some solid tumors. Now, that doesn't mean it's in general. But there were people out there saying, well, as soon as we get what the antigen is on the leukemia, we're going to vaccinate everybody. But if you got the wrong immune response, you're going to make them way more susceptible for one of those rare cancer cells to outgrow the immune system. So I would say caution is really called for here. We can deliver anti-CD47 in a safe way with almost no adverse events related to it. And we can do it for a couple years. But that doesn't mean we're going to go to the general population and find out what the downside was.
Dr. Vogelstein, did you want to comment?
No, I thought that was a great answer. No better.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, gentlemen.